absolute garbage.
Out to
Jibru Mr. Maya.
Jibru Mr. Maya.
Jibru Mr. Maya. Back with another public service announcement.
Back with another public service announcement.
Yo, what's up, Cape Town? Welcome back to it. It's another episode of the PSA podcast. I go by the name of Mr. May, and of course, we're still rocking it, still giving you guys the daily updates, trends, what's happening in South Africa. And today, Waleed Parnell.
What's up?
How you doing, my brother?
I'm good, man. How are you?
Fantastic. I'm so happy that you're here. I didn't want to tell people what happened, but I mean, to get you here was a mission. But the man flew all across the world.
Yeah.
To get here. Talk about that, man. So the man was out in, was in London?
I was in the UK, up in Newcastle.
Okay.
I was there for a month, yeah, playing out there, and I got back like the other day.
How's the time in weather differences for people that have not been?
It's a lot colder in Cape Town now.
Is it?
So generally, in the northeast in England, it's very cold and wet.
Yeah.
But for some reason, when I was there, it was hot for 3 weeks.
Fantastic.
And then it rained for a few days. So like, I had all these coats and everything. Didn't even need it.
You brought it home.
Yeah, exactly.
Listen, Simon. I mean, we obviously know you pretty as we know the journey where it all started for you. But just a little bit, just introduction in short. Where did the cricket life start for you?
In the streets.
In the streets.
Yeah.
You grew up in you grew up in PE, right?
In PE, yeah. Okay. The northern areas of Booysen Park, and like any, colored kid, you just play sport in the street. I mean, we weren't exposed to any facilities or things like that.
So you're playing
that.
The road, like you're under the street lights.
Used to have,
fantastic.
Yeah. So, you know, like there was an old advert when I think it was a Standard Bank advert when they said, "Oh, mom, it's a day and night
game." It's a day and night game. So that's an epic advert.
So, literally, that was literally how we like started. Yeah, yeah. And the funny thing was, so like I had a group of friends who were, I was always the youngest.
Okay.
My brother's 7 years older than me. And obviously, he had a like group of guys.
His friends, okay.
So I always used to play with them. So I was like probably, I'm saying like probably 7 or 8. And they were all like 14, 15, 16, you know. And I always used to play with them. And obviously, in the summer, it was cricket. In the winter, we used to play soccer. Sometimes we'd even play like tennis as well. Obviously, when it's Wimbledon on.
No rugby? No rugby in the road as well?
Rugby, not in the road.
In the road, okay.
But there was a little grass patch. So like one of the neighbors had like a small grass patch. So we used to play rugby there. It was a very small patch, actually, come to think of it.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised like not more people got tackled into the actual tar.
Listen, talk about that. Now you talk about your brothers and your brother and your friends and things like that. Any of them become pro? Any of them get into the cricket game?
I mean, you know, growing up there, it was obviously very tough. And it's crazy, actually, because whenever I go down to PE and, you know, myself and my brother, we have conversations about like, hey, where's this guy? Where's that? And unfortunately, I mean, you know, as things go, a lot of them have passed away
through gangsterism
and all these types of things. And
God rest his souls.
And some guys are in prison as well. And and you know, it's like these things that you see in
documentaries. You grew up on the dodgy side of PE.
No, listen.
You
know? I mean,
grew up on the dodgy side of PE,
this
bro.
This is the thing. Like people see me and they assume I'm like this type of guy, but like they don't. And I think maybe on purpose, I've like kind of kept my private life private and like my upbringing. Not that I'm embarrassed about it.
No, this is why you're here, because we want to unpack all of this.
Yeah.
So tell us, what do you used to smoke? What do you used to drink? Where you
used to I used to actually drink, obviously back in the day.
Okay.
But no, but that's the thing. Like obviously growing up there, I think that's what shaped me.
Yes.
I mean, all those experiences, you know, seeing a lot of violence, you know, a lot of drugs and gangsterism and that type of stuff. And for some reason, I went
the other
way. Yeah.
Nah, like, it's not going to work for me.
But
eh?
It's like, I was just going to say, like, you know, you watch these documentaries about, like, these athletes who make it out of these rough neighborhoods and stuff. And it's basically how the whole neighborhood
supports you because they really want you.
This person.
Oh, so you were like, so that was
so
you.
That was, so like, obviously, like, we used to have little sections.
Everyone away from
to,
Wayne.
No, it was a case of like, we used to have like fights and stuff with like people from like different areas.
Yeah.
So, and like, we used to play cricket against different areas. So it's like, it used to be like the Boerkool versus the church boys. So, so there was a like church, and then outside the church, There used to be a little patch where we used to play cricket there.
Cricket
so,
over there,
so that little crew there, they used to be called the, like, church boys.
Okay, shout out to the church boys if any of them are watching this,
almost,
you know.
Almost like the temple boys, yeah.
Okay,
you know
but
what
that
I'm
was
saying? Like that type of stuff. And then sometimes something would happen, obviously, and then it would be a fight. So it would be our group against their group.
So you were
but
pushing
for some reason, nah, I was never involved.
Okay.
I was keen, but then they were like, Nah, look here, you...
You'd rather stay away. You got a bright future.
But I'm not sure if it was because of the sport or because of the fair skin.
Okay.
You know, back in the day, they're like, this whitey, Buddha.
You're going to choose.
Like,
you to play on the team and not to fight with.
Like, so yeah. I was kind of protected from that. And even my like brothers group as well, obviously they were a lot older, so they were into things a lot worse than what we were. And again, yeah, same thing. Like it was, you know, whenever there's violence or fighting, whatever, like they make sure that like I'm somewhere
you're not in
the corner,
park,
like hidden
park
away.
That man away, yeah.
It's
and
bizarre.
So I mean that it's that bizarre. Gives me a different perspective as to what PE was like growing up, you know what I mean?
No, PE
for you.
Rough.
I mean I've visited PE a few times, and this was maybe in the earlier days. I got some family out in PE as well.
Yeah.
And I mean, I spent some time in PE. For me personally, being a Cape Townian, I always found it to be like super relaxed, much more than Cape Town. Maybe
it's
it's a
mini Cape Town actually.
It is like a mini Cape Town.
A very chilled and like it's a baby brother.
Yeah,
like Cape
they call
Town.
It a friendly city. Is it very friendly?
It's windy. It's the but you know, facts for everyone out there. Statistically, Cape Town gets more wind than PE.
Okay.
I just want to put that.
Just
want
to put that out there. What was but, called? Was it now Gerbega? Was it?
Gerbega. Yeah. GQ.
Yeah. Gerbega. I know. It's just changed. I'm like, how are people feeling about that? Do you have family that's still living up there?
Yeah. My parents, my brother, and my sister all still there.
All still in PE.
Yeah. So like, I mean, everyone still calls it PE anyway. I mean, it's gonna take a while for it to kind of catch on.
So from PE, Port Elizabeth. Port Elizabeth.
PE.
Yeah. So I mean, so that's what I mean. Just going back to it. I mean, so you growing up there, the neighborhood you were from, you said is
Boyson Park, which is now apparently very, very rough.
So the rough now?
Like back then, it wasn't too bad. Maybe also because I was a lighty, so like you don't see these things, you know what I'm saying? But so basically, what happened was obviously as the northern areas expanded, it could only get to a certain point. So there was like basically like bush and everything, and then you get like Dispatch, where Rassie Erasmus is from.
Yes.
And then Uitenhage.
Uitenhage,
which I'm sure everyone's heard of.
Uitenhage.
So there was basically like this bush, right? Then what ended up happening was low-cost housing on the one side, and then obviously, where's the other place? On the other side.
Okay.
So Boyson Park basically became like trapped in this low-cost, on the one side, low-cost on the other side. And then obviously, as things go, like it just filters.
Sort of meshing and like, things like it,
And then, like, a lot of the people, like, moved out as well. And then, again, like, because there's now more people and there's obviously poverty and you have a lot of time on your hands, so what do you do?
More crime.
Basically, that's what it is, you know?
Because I was out there then. I recall just being on, but I was staying on at a hotel in Summerstrand on the beach.
Oh, Summerstrand is nice. Yeah.
But I actually spoke to someone just the other day. I was like, you know what? I think PE needs to have a market on Sunday. On Summerstrand, because I mean, there's nothing happening.
So they used to have it. It used to be nothing called the flea market.
Oh, so they used to have something. Like, so I looked for it when I was there. I was like, damn.
You know where MacArthur's pools are?
Yes.
So just to the left of it, that little walkway thing there.
Yeah.
That used to have like little stalls and all these things.
So
there.
Why did they stop there? There was a vibe.
I mean, people don't really buy things, do they? But they used to have like, so literally anything and everything, little crafts and things and jewelry and all that type of stuff.
But I mean, obviously so you got family. I mean, you got your family still up there. I mean, you obviously in Cape Town or you're traveling and stuff. But I mean, if you should choose between the two, where you'd actually stay? Cape Town instead of
Cape Town is the best city in the world.
Thank you very much.
I've been to so many countries. I've seen so many cities and stuff. But like for me, Cape Town is because it speaks to me like who I am as a person, you know, I'm mixed race.
Yeah.
If I want to be politically correct, but I'm racially ambiguous.
Okay.
Meaning that wherever I go in the world, people can't place me.
Yeah.
Right. And that's
so
like,
I mean, you think you're
it's
white.
A good, it's a good, so there's my dad is white.
Full on white.
My dad is white.
Full on.
Yeah.
Okay, then you're
and my mom is colored. So I'm like what, a third or quarter.
A quarter.
Basically.
You go back and we did the gene pool. Dad's like a quarter Sweden. Mom is 15% Malay, which makes me whatever. You know.
So that's the thing. Yeah. And when I like travel, like people, when they speak to me, they're like, oh, where are you from? Like, what's your accent? Because like my accent is obviously South African, but like it's not like a white South African.
Yes.
So it's still a bit mixed. And I went to like Gray High School in PE, so I've got a bit of a twang.
Okay.
You know, but like, yeah, when I go, then they're like, so when I go to the UK, they, are you Moroccan? Are you Turkish? Are you Tunisian, Algerian? You know, and like, it's both good and bad because like, I don't experience, you know, like a lot of like racism.
Okay.
Which like, when I speak to my wife, then like she's come to the UK obviously a few times with me, and like she experiences that.
Okay.
Because like there, then you know, if you any Asian, you Pakistani.
Okay.
And like they don't like Pakistanis there.
And there's okay, so you just all under that banner.
So that yeah.
Is someone have a hard time out there?
Like it's tough, yeah. And I mean
yeah.
Like I said, I'm lucky in a way that I haven't experienced a lot of that. Yeah. But I also feel sad sometimes because like I've had all the experiences growing up.
Yeah.
You know, as a kid from the ghetto.
But
now like I go around and like I get treated well. Which fantastic. I mean it's good, but like it's also, you know,
shout out to Face Skin.
Why should I complain? Yeah.
Okay. So now when I don't go a bit into it, man. So now listen. Now obviously, you've got work life. You obviously got personal life. You got kids. I mean, so we know that. How do you find the balance between the two? Because I think we had the conversation a little bit, Aisha, about
yeah.
that. Just like how's that been working for you? Like in a mental way.
I found the balance. It's so difficult because like the whole sort of strategy or plan behind the family thing was like, okay, cool. Because remember a few years ago, the UK was still part of the EU.
Yeah.
Before Brexit. And there used to be this thing called a coal pack, which is, it allowed me to play in the UK as a local.
Okay.
But I had to give up the rights to play for South Africa. So okay. That was between 2018 and I think about 2020, right?
So you agreed, obviously.
Yeah. So. And the idea behind that was like, you know, because with international cricket, there's a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of tours to different countries and you don't know where you're going to be. And we were at that stage, we were thinking about starting a family. So I was like, listen, I'm going to do this because like, I want to have 6 months in the UK
yeah.
and 6 months in SA. And I think like we'll have stability in terms of like, we're going to start a family. I want to be present, you know, and then it's like, then Brexit happens and then there's no coal packs and I have to come back here again. And then I'm back into the Proteus setup. And then it just kind of gets like chaotic.
No,
again.
I get you that. And so what I'm trying to say, what I guess on a more flatline question I'm trying to say is like, do you feel like any part of you might be suffering? Now, when I say that, like, do you feel like maybe not spending enough time with the kids or
yes.
maybe not spending enough time just being home, you
yes.
know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, on the one side, you have to be thankful and you have to be grateful.
100%.
You know what I'm saying? But for every pro, there's always a con.
Yes.
You know, they say, what's the saying? Too much of a good thing is never a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, so again, like it's great that I'm working and I'm able to, you know, earn money and be able to provide for my family. But then the negative side is that I miss a lot of milestones.
Milestones.
You know, I've
no,
missed
and
so many birthdays. I've missed so many things. But I guess that's also
the
part of life
you have
and,
to make.
And
sacrifice. No, and I ask this because again, I think lots of us, like let's say even within the industry, is going through that because obviously you have to be at events, you have to show up here, you
yeah.
have to be here and there, you have this, you have these shoots, you have that shoots, and so now what everyone else just sees like, okay, it's clean, it looks beautiful, it's fantastic, that's what success looks like, but not knowing that you're still a real person and,
yeah.
me, and obviously sometimes you wish like could there not be like three of me at the same time, you know, one to be at home.
Yeah.
One to be at the game and another one just to chill at home. No, that'll be fantastic.
Well, they should actually. I don't know if you've seen the new season of Black Mirror.
I have.
So the one episode where like they're in space and there's a replica on
that's
Earth.
That's fantastic. Did you check
so
it out?
That would actually be a
did
nice
you see how
thing.
That episode ended, by the way?
I know, yeah.
It's
sad.
No?
It's crazy.
I honestly thought that was going to go a different way. Anyone
same,
else not?
Same,
that, if
same.
You have not watched Black Mirror, but shout out to them. I mean, it's crazy if you like stuff. For mindfucks, watch it. I mean, I watched all. I assumed he was going to kill that guy and go be with the family.
That's what I thought.
And I was like, what? He did what?
That's exactly what I thought. Then when he woke up with the bloody blood on his hands, I was like, oh, okay.
Well, he's like, okay, you know what? Fuck you. You're going to feel the same pain
yeah,
I feel right now.
Yeah.
We're in this together.
And then
because
he like, just when the guy comes back, he just pushed out the chairs like,
come
sit at my table.
Now. You can most now.
Let's eat together.
Let's eat together. Because I think he also knew that had he killed him, nothing was
yeah, happening. Exactly.
They wouldn't survive up
exactly.
there in any case. Mm. Anyways, that's like something completely off topic, guys. But go check out that episode of Black Mirror. Anyways, getting back to it. So now, future plans. Someone asked me this. They said, ask Barney, listen, if you had to come to a decision like, okay, you know what? I'm done with cricket now. Let's say it's not now. Let's say it's 5 years, 6 years. Doesn't matter. You're like, you know what? I'm throwing the towel. I'm done. What would you do if not play cricket?
That's a good question. Like, I have a few things that I'm interested in and I think that would fulfill me. I think obviously like going into the like coaching space, that's one thing.
Yeah.
I feel like with the experience that I've built up over the last 15 years of, you know, playing professionally, I have a lot of knowledge that I can, you know, pass on to the, yes, to the younger generations. Also, like working in like media, in like cricket. When I was injured a couple of years ago, I did a little bit of that in the local competition, and I actually really enjoyed it. Because again, it's something that I know. So like I'm talking about things that I know about, and just trying to get like the average person to understand that. So that is definitely something. The other thing that I really would love to have is to own a coffee shop, like a nice. I know it might sound like weird and like
completely. Don't you already?
No, I mean like our own one.
Okay. That's
like, you know, it's got our own flavor onto it.
Okay,
like,
that kind of vibe. Yeah.
I think that's something that, again, like, it's weird because I'm not like a people's person.
Yeah.
Like, and you probably need to be like that in a coffee shop, but like I feel like I can connect well with like people.
I think it's a spot for people's people.
Yeah.
You just give them the space with a good brew of coffee.
Maybe, yeah.
So I mean this is like your journey right now. So now obviously the people have been seeing your TikToks as well. This is something you want to dip into.
Yeah.
They want to know, are you a little bit of a fashionista?
I haven't been active on TikTok lately. Yeah.
You used to clap the videos every week. I was like, if I'm going on TikTok, I'm like, Barney's posting another video. The man's swagging out here again. I mean, how did you incorporate that? I mean, you know, are you playing professional cricket, but you know, the TikTok used to come without fail. How did you kind of partner those two?
Well, it started during lockdown.
Yeah.
I mean, as a lot of things started. So during lockdown, like, my wife Aisha, she was actually on it, and she was like, oh, have you heard of this thing like TikTok? Like, this is the like new thing. And I was like, what's TikTok? So I scrolled through and I was like, oh, this looks like a lot of effort and it looks boring. Just started creating more videos and just started having more fun. And I was like, that's quite cool, because also like that audience was a completely different audience to my Instagram and Twitter and stuff like that. So like,
I'm sure you have like people who are fans of your TikToks that obviously have some maybe don't know even that
this well, is that's a
cricket
thing,
player, like, you know what I mean?
I have followers on TikTok who probably don't even know that I play cricket.
You play cricket, yeah.
And that I have Instagram. And probably the other way around as well. Because what I've also tried to do with my social media is not like feed people too much of like, hey, I play cricket. Because people know that about me.
Yeah.
But like, what else is it to this guy? And like, those are the layers that I want to get across. And also like, it's my social media.
So
I want to post what I want to post. Like, so if I feel like posting a selfie, like, you know, looking fly or whatever, like, I want to do that.
That's what you're
going
to do,
I think it rubs people up the wrong way, though. And it has for a very long time.
Like how, in what sense?
I mean, I'm sure if you did some sort of poll and asked, like, who's the most hated cricketer in South Africa or in South African history, I reckon my name would be up there.
You'd be up there.
Because, like, from a young age, I just felt I was different. Like, I mean, growing up, you know, in a rough colored neighborhood, being a light skinned guy, I was teased for being light skinned.
Yeah.
I didn't look like everyone else. And like, I was like, you know what? I don't care. Like, and I just loved playing sport.
Yeah.
So I used to play every single sport at like, you know, primary school.
So if it
streets.
Wasn't cricket also, I mean, if it
wasn't every, cricket. I'm talking about, I played soccer, I played rugby, I played tennis, I played volleyball, I played cricket, obviously. I even like, so during break time, I used to play netball with the like girls.
Netball, yeah, okay. Yeah.
So obviously, and then like we used to play soccer, like, you know, with a tennis ball and that type of stuff. And I was the top goal scorer, by the
just
way.
Just putting it out there.
Just putting it out there. And like, again, I was always different. So I was, you know, always different. And then going into high school at Grey, which was like predominantly white. So I fit in physically, but I think mentally and emotionally, I didn't fit in because I'm not like that. I'm not wired like that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm from the streets.
Like, and how, I mean, I'm struggling. So what were some of the differences? I mean, I know we're obviously bouncing off different things.
Yeah, no.
But then how were they? How, I mean, like, I'm talking about like classmates and things like that. I mean,
yeah,
what
so like a few of the guys from the under 13 provincial cricket team obviously went to the school as well. So I knew them from the like tour. But then you like, the more you spent, and you're like, we're actually not the same. Because I spent like 7 or 8 days with him. And then you're like, okay, no, we're cool. I'm like these guys. But the only thing we have in common is the fact that we play cricket.
Okay.
But when you at school every day, then you're like, oh, actually, I'm more like these other colored people. Yeah.
These are actually my peeps. Yeah.
And even though, like, they, again, don't look like me, they are like me.
They are like, yeah.
You know, so we can connect on that level. And but even like when I was at boarding school as well, I used to get moored like, for the first,
so
I don't know.
That was
like,
mood in you.
Yes, you know, it's like a whole like hierarchy thing. And
okay.
And I was a grade 8. And, you know, from the streets, like, we don't, there's no like age thing. It's like you stand your ground.
Yeah.
And like there, it's obviously about respect and discipline. And
where's this boarding school in?
Yeah, Grey High School. Mm. And a lot of like, I mean, Sia went there. You know, there are a lot of other athletes who've come from that school and like probably had similar, maybe different experiences. But like, it was a case of like navigating the space, you know what I'm saying? And like these grade 11s and matric guys, like, because it was a thing like you had to wait at the door for them and they have to like say it's fine.
It was like a whole fucking thing like that. Like,
yeah. I mean, it's, I'm grateful for it because like it teaches you like there's more to life than just being like, listen, you have a problem with me, let's fight.
Yeah.
You know, there's other ways to like resolve things as well. So like it opened up my mind to this different world. But I used to just go and they're like, like I said, the first term definitely, like I used to get murd like every other day. And then like we used to have this thing called the old pot.
Okay.
Because now we're the new pots, the grade eights, and you assigned like a matric.
Is this a school thing or is this a culture thing that they created?
What's this thing that used to be back in the day? Spud.
Spud, yes, yeah. Okay. So you had initiations.
I don't know if I haven't watched the like movie, so I can't
watch Spud,
say
like
if
epic.
It's accurate or not, but it's like similar to that, yeah. So
okay.
Like a lot of traditions and stuff like that. So my old pot was a black African guy who was at Grey on a cricket scholarship as well.
Okay.
So obviously we had the cricket thing in common. We both like not white, so we understand. So he said to me like, listen, like you're going to get into trouble like all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just put
because,
it out
like,
there.
You're not you are different. Okay. I understand that. But like, just do these things. If you do these things, you'll be all right.
You'll be okay.
So I was like, okay, cool. Like, I can still be who I am, but I just have to do A, B, C, and D, and E.
Okay.
And then you kind of learn the ropes and then you kind of go like that. But again, like I said, like, because we only, and I think that's the, you know, and as bad as apartheid was, like, that's the beauty of it. Because like, to this day, they're still apartheid with us not even knowing about it because we're still segregated. We still, you know, there's still like these white areas where people don't know what's happening in colored areas, in black
at all,
areas. You understand what I'm saying? So like it's worked, but that's the crazy thing. Like growing up, like I've experienced all sides, which has probably shaped the way I am. And I've just always wanted to be myself and be different. And then I come into the space of now being a public figure and like being this international athlete. And like, I mean, I was always like, I shaved my hair. Like I had a bloody ponytail.
Yeah.
I had blonde hair. And like, again, like I think, and maybe this is like the old school way of, you know, you have to dress like this. You have to have your hair combed like this. And you have to speak like this. And I was just like, I'm not that.
But that's not who I am.
And I feel like the public didn't take to that.
Yeah.
They're like wider. Because if you think about it, like the general population of South Africa, people think it's like predominantly like white, but it's not. White people are the minority in this country.
Yeah.
But in terms of like what you see, maybe, well, cricket, a lot of white people watch cricket.
Yeah.
So now they see this young kid on the block, like he's different. Like, why is he different? Like, what is this?
What is
it? You know what I'm saying?
And have you ever decided that you're going to act in and like, I'm just going to try this for a while?
I tried it for a bit.
Like, to see if, like, if it's a vibe. Like, okay, no.
Horrible.
Is it horrible?
Horrible. Because you, at the end of the day, you lose who you are.
Yeah.
And like, if I spend time with you for the next week or two, like I can fake who I am. I can be like this amazing person. And like, you'd be like, your partner is like this
exactly
guy.
Cool. Like, always,
but if we spend time for 6 months, a year, 2 years, eventually, like if I'm a cuck person, like that's going to come
out.
That's
going to show. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So like, you can fake it for a little bit and try and fit in, but
that's
like
tired,
eventually, that's a thing.
Fucking tired,
so I felt like I just lost myself a little bit. And then it got to a stage where I wasn't enjoying cricket. So I was like, you know what? What's the point of me? Like, I love playing cricket because this is like, this brings me joy. But like, it comes with all of this other nonsense. And like, no one likes me.
And have you ever felt that any point in me like, you know what? Fuck, I'm going to leave this. I'm done playing cricket. Like, I'm done with this cuck now.
So literally just before signing a cold pack, I mean, the biggest part of that was the family thing, but the other part was also like, you know what, I'm gonna go into it because I'd been to the UK before to go play county cricket and stuff like that, and just the way that it is there, because people, like, again, maybe because of the skin that I have, they don't realize like who I am back in South Africa.
Yeah.
So there I'm just a cricket player, and it's like you do well and it's like, oh, this guy's actually like decent, and
he's
like
decent,
he does well for our club and like we like him, you know, and that's all it is. So when I went to, over again in 2018, it was the same thing.
Yeah.
And that was at a point where I didn't really enjoy cricket that much. And I was like, you know what? And I was speaking to Aisha about this and I was like, I don't really like it. Like, I wasn't committed at all. Like, I went because I was obviously contracted and like...
And you have
to
work. It's work.
You have to. And it's, I'm getting paid at the end of the month and I have to provide for my wife and myself. Yeah. And then obviously like, then go in there and then just... You know, as I say, like,
yeah,
it but now I'm looking at the, something.
Yeah, if I look at that, I mean, if you're looking at maybe early South Africa and things like that, and also like where we are at right now. So, like, did you feel like almost like you were supposed to like fit a specific model?
Yes.
Of like, I'm supposed because now obviously we hadn't come to the part where people were okay, like, I'm proud to be, you know, or this is my culture, or I'm proud of this is who I am. Because now you're with other people and this is what they believe in, this is the prestige and this is the level I'm supposed to be at. At what point do you say, well, but fuck that? What I am or who I am is fucking great as well, and maybe you guys just haven't got the picture yet.
Well, I think that's the thing is sometimes when you are yourself, it makes other people uncomfortable.
Yeah, but it makes you uncomfortable for them being themselves. So,
no, the thing is, if they are who they are, and I am who I am, I'm fine with it.
Yes,
but when I am who I am, and it doesn't fit their narrative of how I should be, you know. Then it makes them uncomfortable because
why are we trying to fit narrative like, still? You know what I mean?
No, but that's what I'm saying. So yeah. I started playing professionally. This was in 2007.
2007. Right? Yeah.
The world was a different place that back then. You know, you could say certain things and like no one would be offended.
Yeah.
Now if you say the wrong word, it's like, oh, we need to cancel this guy because like.
Yeah, the cancel culture is wild, bro.
But that's what I'm saying, and you know, I'm what 33 now, so probably in the last, I'd say. Honestly, like in the last 5 years, like the world has changed like a lot and quickly as well. And it's made it a safe space for people to just be themselves.
Be themselves
and like,
yeah.
It's more inclusive as well.
And what do you think about this whole cancel culture thing though? Like people trying to cancel like you say anything wrong, like, you know, social media, like just like this one thing that maybe just win against other people's, I don't know, narratives or what they believe in. It's like, cancel him off. I don't want to hear from him again, you know?
I think the problem is that like whatever you say is always going to offend someone.
Someone, yeah, for sure.
So basically, you have to say nothing. So then the best way is just to be quiet.
But now you say nothing, you know what I'm saying? Then
everyone is upset with you because you don't have an opinion.
Yeah. So what do you do?
You understand?
You know, I even discussed this on a previous podcast where it's like, I would say things like, let's say in the early days, I don't know if you saw any of the early videos that I did, man. I used to say outlandish stuff.
Yeah.
Like wild stuff.
But that's why I actually started following. I was like, who's this guy? Like, he just says whatever he wants. I'm like,
and that was
this is nice. You know what I'm saying?
Because and that was a mold that we were trying to break out. We're like, you know, fuck. This is like, it could be like maybe 12, 13 years ago. We're like, you know what? This is who we are. And we're going to say it like it is. And sometimes it's not always meant to be offensive. It was just kind of also mirroring some of the stuff you saw growing up.
Yeah.
Imagine you were, if you maybe just acted out a fight scene that happened in PE.
Yeah.
And some of the things that were said on a video. And it was like, fuck, is that party? Be like, yeah, Slatterman said whatever.
Yes,
you know what
exactly.
I mean? But that's what you saw.
Yeah.
And my art is my realities. And I was given this. And I was like, this is what I saw on a day-to-day basis. Man, I lived in the wood. I lived in the ghetto. I saw things like this going on. So I'm not telling you something that you don't know. But to other people, it's like, oh my gosh, that's
you've
like,
got, yeah.
You're taking it too far, bro.
You can't say that.
Jeez, like, how kid you? Like, fuck, bro.
How dare you
like,
say
how,
that, bro?
Like, how dare you? I was like, my bro, come to the neighborhood. I'm going to tell you straight. Jai, your push, komisa.
But that's how
but
it
was.
Life,
you know?
That's life every day. Like, that's what we grew up. And that's what I'm saying. Like, for me, going into the hostel was like, yo, it was tough. Because, like, I've got this guy. I'm saying, and I'm standing my ground again. But it doesn't work like a one-on-one fight there.
Okay.
It's the grade. So like your whole grade. So that's it. It teaches you
so
like
what,
a lot of things.
They're all going to come through together with
so
you.
It teaches you like teamwork as well. So like if you are out of line, it's my responsibility to pull you into line because we're all going to get murdia. You understand?
Oh, okay.
So it's like it teaches you a lot of different life skills. So,
I think it's great. We're just having a whole gang system going on. They're like, bro, Jai, what are you doing? You come here.
Yeah.
Everyone's just talking about
like,
it first.
So like, for instance, one of the things was like, if so you have to make your bed at a certain time, then there's inspection, then there's breakfast, then obviously school starts. But like if you do something wrong, then it's like you're in trouble. Now the next morning at like 5 o'clock, the whole grade has to go run around the field like 10 times or whatever, like something like that as like punishment. Yeah. So it teaches you, like, this is
sounds
teamwork.
Like a prison a little, like.
It's teamwork. the grade eights yeah. and the, you know, it's like, that's how it was. And okay. again, now you become smarter. So it's like, okay, if you get into trouble, it's not just you in trouble. It's all of us.
All of us. Okay.
So now it's like, now it teaches you about, like, brotherhood.
Okay. So we all, like, have to teamwork. Collectively do the
yes,
shit together. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So if everyone does a little bit, we can achieve a lot. So, like, that's the type of stuff. Now, when you're growing up in the ghetto, like, it's like, elke man for himself. You yeah. know what I'm saying? Like, that's how it, that's how it is. So it teaches you a lot of different life skills. And, like, you don't realize it when you're going through it. But now, when I'm older, like,
and
I'm
makes
like,
much I'm better thankful team play, I guess,
because
eh?
I could have ended up way worse. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So now, also, obviously, now getting into the proteas and things like it, was there any initiations, anything that you had to do? Because now you're talking about grades and what some of the stuff. There's nothing there.
Nah. Nothing, yeah, there's nothing like that. I mean,
that's in your pond, now, you need to lick these two cricket balls.
Yeah, grab some balls. Now there's, like, we have this, like, ceremony, obviously with, like, protea, you know, the significance of the flower and what it symbolizes.
Yeah.
And, like, the fire. So, basically, a protea is the first flower to regenerate after a fire. So
okay.
Now we have, like, felt fires, and that's actually how they grow and spread. Mm. It's through, like, these felt fires.
Still our national flower, right? Is it?
I don't know.
I believe it is.
I should probably know this if it is.
If it is. Well, I believe it's the national flower, the protea.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
You heard it here first. So it's quite a nice, and it's basically a thing of, like, the guys who have been there, like, obviously welcoming the next member into this group. And we actually did this team building thing with this guy from New Zealand a couple of years ago. And obviously, you know, the, like, Maori culture
yeah.
and all of that type of stuff. They like, basically believe in this thing that, like, we're just, like, a long chain.
Well, as in life, like, as in...
Yeah, as, well, as the whole
the existence
sort
of
existence
everything.
Of, like...
Okay.
And in this particular context, obviously, this team, this Proteus team or family or whatever you want to call it. And the sun is shining on us now. So the sun is on me now,
yeah.
but at some stage I'm shifting slowly.
Yes.
And I'm going to be out of the sun, and then the next guy down there is going to be in the sun.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, when you look at it like that, it's quite powerful, actually, because
everyone,
like,
gets the chance for the sun to
yes,
shine on them.
Yes. And also, like, and again, also then with Islam, it's a case of, like, what's written for you is whatever you do and try and do differently, like, what is meant for you will find you. You know
it's
what I'm
written.
Saying? So, like, it's done.
Yeah.
So then I, like, throw all of these things in, and I'm just basically, like, I play cricket because I like playing cricket, and that's it.
Yeah.
I just play because I love playing cricket. And when I don't like it, doing it anymore, I'm going to stop.
Mm. And so then also, where did the switch come? Wayne, Walid, where did he...
Yeah, so
what happened? What happened,
in,
bro?
2010, we were in the UAE, so we were
okay.
playing against Pakistan there. And obviously, like, there's a mosque in every single corner there.
Mm.
You know, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and that. And it's just interesting, like, obviously just seeing, like, how they kind of live their lives and stuff like that. And I mean, Dubai is probably not a good representation of Islam.
Oh, yeah.
you know. But then coming back, so one of my best friends is a Muslim guy.
Yeah.
And he's from PE. We went to school together, actually, and, like, we didn't talk about, like, religion or stuff like that.
Mm.
And we just had this weird experience where I'd come back, and there was another guy who's, like, he's older than us. He's probably, like, 20 years older than us. And
yeah.
he used to be a manager of a shop in Greenacres, which is our, like, waterfront mall.
Okay.
and after training and stuff, we always used to sit there with him, and, like, we used to just talk about, literally, about soccer. And, like, he used to play hockey. And we talk about hockey, and we talk about cricket, and that's it. Not
yeah.
about religion or anything like that. And one afternoon, like, my friend goes, like, oh, I'm going home because I have to go to the mosque. Like, it was Maghrib.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, can I come with? And he's like, yeah. Like, we like,
wait, best, how long ago was
this? This was now at the end of 2010.
End of 2010. Okay, so
and
you
we're
check,
like,
okay,
best buds. So, like, you don't think anything of it. You're like, yeah, come.
Come,
like,
I'm going to check the vibe out. Okay.
So we go home. We go to his house. Then we go to the mosque. Then, like, there's a four or five Jamaat guys from Malaysia, right?
That are there, yeah.
So obviously after Maghrib, they give, like, talks and stuff like that. But, like, so he said this to me afterwards only. Like, he was like, it's weird because, like, he doesn't often sit for, like, these talks. Like, he'll read Salah and then, like, go outside or, like, go back home. And, like, for some reason, that maybe because I was there, like, I just, because I didn't really know what was going on. I just sat there. And like then they started talking about like life and like, you know, about like your physical body and like how we do so much to make this physical body look so pretty, and but what happens, you know, inside, what's inside, like what's at your like core, like why don't we work on that, why don't we get that like strong and ripped and whatever, you know what I'm saying? And I was like, wow, this is like quite interesting actually.
And then I mean, how were you raised? I mean, were you raised Orthodox Christian?
So my mom is like quite Christian, and still to this day.
And I mean, when
my dad was like, and I think this is probably the one good thing about my dad is like, he's a whatever you want to follow, do that.
Open-minded, like, so he's like, okay.
And like, he's not one to like really judge. He's be like, if that's what you want to do and you believe in that and you want to follow that, go with
it. And by all means,
you know, as long as you don't hurt people along the way and you don't do bad things.
And it's good for you.
That's it, yeah.
So when you got to the official change, when that happened, when did that happen?
Well, this is what I'm saying now. So then these guys are like, listen, who's going on 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, this.
You put your hand up.
I'm like, what is this guy? And I just see like these different guys like putting their hands up. And then the one guy is looking at me the entire, I'm clocking him.
Yeah.
And he's just looking at me, and then like he comes like through this crowd, like, and I'm just sitting there, and he looks at me, he's like, brother, you haven't made any intention. And he's from like Malaysia, so his accent's a bit like different. I'm like, what do you mean?
Yeah.
And he's like, you're not doing any Jamaat work. And I was like, I'm looking at my friend there. He's laughing.
Yeah.
Because like now I'm putting this like tight spot. I'm like, I don't know what this guy's talking about. He's like, what is your name, brother? I said, Wayne. He's like, no, you are Waleed. I'm like, he just said that. He's like, Waleed. And I'm like, cool. Like, and then he starts telling me about,
well,
you know,
that.
Prince Waleed and you know, story of like Khalid.
Yeah.
And then I'm like,
Waleed.
I'm like, wow, this is interesting. Cool. Like, again, just like, this is just fascinating. Mm. Then afterwards, we go to my friend's house. We have dinner. And his mom was now like quite excited about this. And they all laughing at me.
Because you were in the mosque. And,
yeah.
Okay.
But like,
so did you pray with him also, by the way? The day you went?
Yeah. So I just followed, like, I didn't know what was going on. I just followed. But the one thing that I really loved about Islam was the brotherhood, man. Like, where I don't know this person on this, I don't know this person on this, but we're all doing the same thing. And like, in that moment, like, our sole focus and purpose is on our Creator.
Yeah.
And like, nothing else matters. Like, this could be a CEO of like a multi-billion-dollar company.
But together, we all just the same.
Could be, you know, cleaning toilets like next door. But like in that, you know, those couple of minutes, like, it's everything, the focus is the same. So then she gets this book with all these names, and she's like, what did the guy say, Waleed? And she's going there and go to the W and check. And it's like, Waleed means like newborn son.
Newborn son.
So I'm like, yo, this is like, but weird.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like this, like when all these coincidences like happen, like one after each other, then you're like, nah, man. There has to be something in
there. There has to be something, yeah.
So then just did some research like for the next couple of months. And then like, so fast forward to 2011, just before I went to the IPL actually, said my shahada, and then...
You embraced Islam.
Said, yeah.
And what's that journey been like for you though? I mean, this is like, I didn't expect to get into all of this though. But I mean, I'm also a little bit interested in that as well. I mean, what was that like for you? I mean, obviously, because now, I mean, you're still young, you came from all these different backgrounds, and now this is like something completely different. And I mean, you, if anything's to go by, I mean, obviously, just saying the shahada, that's the easy part.
Yeah.
Now it's actually, okay, now I have to live this and do it.
Yes,
and how was that for you? Like, because obviously now, that be the whole... different, that's a whole change, you know what I mean? Because if I even know for myself, you know, obviously someone that has come from a parents that were both religions at the time, so I got a taste of both.
Yeah.
And I know obviously now, once you say, you know, I'm not Christian, I'm now Muslim, there's a whole set of things to now abide by or to live by or to kind of uphold, which sometimes can be tough, if you just start, you know. So I was like, okay, I said the shahada, now I'm actually going to do this thing. How was that?
Yeah, I mean, it was... I wouldn't say it was challenging. It was different.
Yes.
It was different because obviously there's certain rules you have to follow and certain things you can and can't do. And again, it's the nice thing is that like it's a process of like growth because every day is a day and a chance for you to be better than you were yesterday.
Yeah.
You know, to do more than you did yesterday, you know. And I think like to this day, like that is the like challenge for me is just to try and be slightly better than I was yesterday, you know. But in terms of like being a Muslim, it's easy. Like, people think it's difficult, you know, when you drink and or you eat like pork and you're like, yo, how am I going to give up this? How am I going to be, you know? If your mind is set to something, you can do it.
Alhamdulillah.
And it's not like, right, like, I'm standing here now and tomorrow I'm going to climb Mount Everest. It doesn't work like that.
But you know some people, I guess some people perceive it like that sometimes.
That's the problem.
It's like saying like I'm going to become Muslim now, it's going to question
everything. I'm going to be Mufti Mink.
Yeah, or you know, not just
it doesn't
that.
Or work like that.
Yeah, or like they think like, you know what, it's going to question everything about who they think they are.
Because
let's just say if let's say you have addictions or you have, let's say, or something, let's just say whether it's alcohol, whether it's drug, whether it's parties, I mean, which is frowned upon in any religion in any case. But I mean, if this is what your identity is and this is how you show up in the world, like, okay, I'm the party guy or I'm this person. And now all of a sudden you're Islamic and now it's like, okay, cool. Now I can't show up as it. So who am I without these things? Yeah. Now I'm just thinking of some people that I know that have gone through that and like, so who am I if I don't do any of these things anymore?
But that's the thing that I realized before that, though, is that like I was labeled as this like wild child party guy.
Yes.
When I was younger, because like I was when I got into this international cricket thing I was 19.
Yeah.
19, like
living your best life.
What are 19-year-olds doing? Like going out, and I've like when I used to drink, I always used to just be a social drinker.
Okay.
I could, you know, like some people, like they sit at home and they have a couple of beers or whatever, like, and they watch sport. Like, for me, I could only drink when I was like in a club or at a
and
bar.
Out. Okay.
Like that was the only place I would drink. Mm. I would not drink anywhere else. So like, because people saw me out and saw me drinking, they were like, yo, this guy. And then they might assume that, okay, well, other people drink at home as well. So like, yo, this guy drinks a lot. Like he's always partying. It's PEP, so it's small. There's like one place. So everyone goes to the one place. So when you see me there, that's the only place. So now you see me there like maybe every weekend or every second weekend or whatever. It's like, yo, this guy's out all the time. So then you get that label. And I was like, again, and it comes back to this thing of like, now like, you know, why must I not try and impress people or make people believe I'm a different and
but
my
at this
way
time,
of doing
at
things
this time
always,
of drinking where you had you already embraced
no
it.
no, this was before. Okay. So this was like 19, so when I embraced I was 22, so just before turning 20.
Okay, just before turning, okay,
so
I got
talking
you
about like 18 19 20 21, like those 4 years felt like 40 years, but you know, like a lot of partying was like done in that stage. But then like after that, then you're like, okay, cool. Like, but it's a, and having this guy, my best friend, who went to Grey as well, who experienced a lot of this and being Muslim
as well. Yeah.
He was like, you know what? Like, you can still go out. Like, you're obviously just not going to drink, but like, yes, it's maybe not ideal to like go to a club and like, you know, go shake your ass, but you also live in South Africa. You're not living in Saudi Arabia where these things are prohibited. And then it's like, okay, we're using common sense as well, because like we live in a world where things
that's westernized,
and like, you know what I'm saying? And like, I saw this one lecture, I actually can't remember who it was by, but they said like, at the end of the day, like, you live under Sharia law, but you still have to abide by the laws of the country that you're in.
Yes.
So then you're like, oh, okay, cool. So like, Islam is not this thing of like, hey, you must do this and do this and don't do that and don't do that. It's like, we believe in the core things and that's what makes us Muslim. But also like, if I want to go sit in a coffee shop and have a cup of coffee, like, it's okay to do that.
It is okay, yeah.
But some people, like, and in PE, there's, like, this community where they believe, like, you can't go eat out and you can't do this. You must just eat at home. Your family must just cook at home. Like,
yes.
That, you know, but in every part of life, in every group in life, there's always going to be extremists. And that's the thing, like,
then
you
are
just
you
believe, like...
Yeah, so now you're still able to make saliva while being in the UK, making, like, I mean...
Yeah, so, like, and that's... That's the other thing about Islam, is that you can go anywhere in the world, some guy will see you, and I mean, being a professional cricketer, it has its ups and downs, but one of the ups is that, like, if I'm walking somewhere in a foreign country, a foreign city, and like, yes, you can Google, like, where's a mosque or whatever, but like, food, you know, you don't want to just go to some takeaway joint, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like, what
you
a nice halal chow or whatever. Then you see a guy, he's like, hey, you the cricketer? Oh, okay, cool. Listen, come to my house tonight. Like, we have dinner. And I was actually, funny enough, one of the players at Durham, where I was now, he was asking me about this. And I said to him, like, for me, obviously coming from a different background, this is the weird thing. And this is the thing I still struggle with.
Mm-hmm.
But it's such a normal thing, is that, like, I can go anywhere in the world. I can go to a mosque and go to someone and be like, listen, I'm traveling, I don't know where to eat. And they'll say, no, come,
that's fine, come
to
my house. Me, yeah. Come else, yeah.
And he was like, bro, that's so like weird. I was like, it's so weird, but like it's normal.
It's normal,
it's
yeah.
It's just a normal thing. And like, I mean, I've eaten at people's houses from, if you go down south to New Zealand, all the way up to Canada, so and anywhere in between, random people's houses that I've maybe been to once.
So they invited you because you're Muslim and not because they know you're the cricket player.
Some cricket, but it's some like, just, okay, I think yeah, and then they're like, then afterwards they're like, oh, you're this cricket guy. But it's like, it's just fascinating. Yeah.
Mm. Hey! Yeah, so if you guys are feeling good.